State Historical Society. We are celebrating Women's History Month during March, and so we're very pleased to have one of our talks about women's history and about some women who were not so far from here over in the Amana colonies. I want to again give you a couple of quick announcements. Our next talk will be on Wednesday, March 20th. It'll be Wayne Peterson, who's been working with the Department of Agriculture and Land Stewardship many years on water hydrology issues, but that's certainly something that's important to us. On April 10th, we're going to have a talk about the motor mill in Clayton County, a historic mill, and that'll be by Larry Stone and Marla Svensson. And we'll have other talks scheduled at least up through June and July, so we hope you'll join us again or possibly catch them when they're rebroadcast on TV. Today we're honored to have Corey Deerfield here to speak to us. She actually has her folks from Mount Pleasant here today, along with her husband and her daughter Sadie, so we're very glad they made the trip down here to hear this today. We met Corey because she was in our reading room poring through the oral histories that are part of our labor collection. If you don't know this, we have about 1,200 oral histories that were done with rank and file workers all over the state. And a good body of those were actually done out in Amana. And in fact, many were done by Janet Weaver here, who's associated with the Iowa Women's Archives. So we're going to learn something new today because no one's really mined that resource and come out of the stories to tell us what they're about. Corey got her BA in history at Iowa State University and an MA at Western Michigan before going to Purdue, where she got her PhD in May of 2012. We have an important announcement today because we just found out that Corey's going to have an article published in upcoming issues of the Annals of Iowa, so we hope you'll pick that up and read that. The title of her thesis is Earning Her Daily Bread, Women in the Industrial Manufacturing in the Rural Midwest from 1950 to 1980. And again, this is remarkable because there's relatively few studies of urban and rural workers in industrial settings in Iowa after World War II. And so we're really glad she chose to focus this because it's bringing new scholarship to the forefront. So if you'll join me in welcoming Corey, I'm sure we're going to learn some interesting stories today. Thanks for coming.
Thanks, Mary. This presentation on Amana really comes out of my dissertation research that I did. Most of my research was right here in this very room, pouring through oral history records and labor union records. I've spent many, many hours here going through this. And so much of this research comes directly out of this collection, and I think it's really great that I get to present it through this brown bag series in this very room where I did my research. And this particular talk on the women in Amana really encapsulates many of the themes that come out of my dissertation about women in 1950 who chose to go to work in manufacturing. And it really shows how women are going to work in greater numbers in the 1950s. And many people will think about Rosie the Riveter and how women went to work in industry during World War II. But really, that was just kind of a brief hiccup in history where women went to work in the factories and they went back home. What was really remarkable is that more and more women are going to work in industry in the 1950s and in the 1960s. And what's really interesting about Iowa and Amana is that Amana is smack dab in the middle of nowhere. It is a very rural setting. And you have to think, like, when if you have a factory in an urban place, getting workers is no big deal. You have lots of people that are right around in the town. If you're in the middle of a rural setting, trying to figure out where to get your workers is something of a challenge. And so what Amana does and what George Forstner does is to kind of spread out his net and collect workers from the surrounding area. And so I'm just going to talk about kind of where the women are coming from. And they're driving from many, many different towns. They're commuting to work. And this creates a workforce that is very different than what you typically think of maybe in a car factory in Detroit, where it's very urban. This is a very rural setting. So that's kind of what the main themes of this talk is going to be about and some of the main themes that come out of my dissertation. I have an opening vignette of a story of a woman who went to work in Amana, and so I'm just going to read this to you. And she is very typical of the women who chose to go to work, and her name is Eunice Evans. When Eunice Evans left for work in the morning, she heaved a sigh at the sight of her untidy home. I always said that when I left for work, my house looked terrible. But after a grueling 8-hour workday at the Amana Refrigeration Company, the state of her house got remarkably, quote, better, because I was so tired I didn't care anymore, unquote. Evans grew up on a farm near the small town of Wellman. And as a child, she had a lot of dreams like most kids, but nothing serious. And quote, it certainly didn't involve working in a factory, unquote. After a pleasant childhood, she quit high school after the 10th grade and married her high school sweetheart. Her life took a rather unexpected turn when her husband enlisted in the armed forces at the beginning of World War II. He was first stationed in Oklahoma, and Evans followed her husband to Oklahoma and lived there for 2 years. She worked at the postal exchange for a few months in order to make some extra money while her husband was preoccupied with the Army. But she soon became a busy mother, giving birth to 2 sons while living in Oklahoma. When her husband was shipped overseas, Evans moved back to Wellman to be near her family. After the war, her husband returned to Wellman and began working at the Amana Refrigeration Company in the Amana Colonies, which is a 30-mile drive north of Wellman. By the early 1950s, Evans considered working herself, especially when she thought of what she could do with the extra income. Quote, I decided I wanted an adequate diet for my children. I had one boy that had polio, and I always felt it was because he didn't have the meat and fresh fruits that he needed with my salary. We could afford to buy them, unquote. In 1951, Evans joined her husband in Amana. At first, she was uneasy about leaving her children with a babysitter while she went to work. Quote, I think I was rather the exception of going to a factory. I probably was frowned on much more outside of the home, unquote. But the extra income eased many of her concerns. When Evans started at Amana, the factory was expanding due to Korean War contracts, and her first work assignment was pounding nails. She quickly moved on to other jobs in the factory. During her 33 years in Amana, she worked as a welder, a metal finisher, a painter, and inspector, among other jobs. She was a dedicated worker, taking every advantage to work overtime, and was never ashamed to ask for higher wages. She fought for her personal protection with the factory and kept a vigilant watch over her workplace rights to ensure that the company was not taking advantage of her or her coworkers. She was also a pioneer, one of the first women to work in the metal finishing department, a department typically reserved for men. Quote, when I went to metal finishing, it was unknown for any woman to be in there, and they tried very much to have my husband talk me out of it. He told them he couldn't tell me what to do. Unquote. Evans was too stubborn for her husband to talk her out of it, as she had a strong sense of self. Her industrious nature and can-do attitude did not stay in the workplace, but trickled to her home life as well. She kept a garden, canned during the summer, and stayed involved in her family's lives. The life story of Eunice Evans provides a salient example of the lives of many working women in the Midwest who grew up on farms, had husbands who served in the war, and eventually migrated into industrial work to help support their families during the 1950s and 1960s. So Eunice really kind of provides an example of the typical woman who was working at the Amana Refrigeration plant. Just to give you a little background to the Amana Refrigeration Company itself, Amana is the product of the far-seeing and industrious individual of George Forstner, who is going to develop new ways to produce refrigeration products. George Forstner grew up right in the Amana colonies. His father was a shopkeeper in High Amana, and so he grew up in the Amana society and with the Amana traditions. In 1934, he has been tinkering with refrigeration, and he starts to actually sell and install refrigeration coolers from a shed across the street from his father's store. He eventually is going to start selling beverage coolers to restaurants, and he will start out with just having 2 employees working for him. He made these first coolers under the name Amana Electric Company. The Amana Society will then purchase the company and keep George Forstner involved. In 1936, he starts making walk-in coolers for grocery stores. And then when World War II breaks out, he will actually receive a contract to make refrigeration products for the Army in order to provide fresh meat to the troops. And so during World War II, you see the effects of refrigeration that are actually put into use to provide food for for the Army. And the company will actually receive 3 Army Navy Excellent Awards and national recognition for their product. The company is going to continue to grow after the war, making the first upright home freezer in 1947. And it's in 1947 that the company will really start to grow. By 1950, the company is going to be sold to a private group of investors and is no longer going to be owned by the Amana Society. And so by 1950 is when George Forstner will officially break off from the Amana Society. But he will keep the factory right in Middle Amana. So he will keep it in his home base, and it's still there today. During the 1950s, business is really going to expand. The factory is going to continue to make home freezers and refrigerators, and they will actually pioneer the side-by-side door refrigerator and upright and chest freezers for home use. The factory in Middle Amana, when he builds it, is 600,000 square feet with 6 miles of conveyor belts. And so this is a picture, a sky picture of what the factory looks like. And then this is an advertisement here of what their freezer, upright freezer, looked like in the 1950s. And I'm always very amazed how much food they've got packed into this. And in fact, I use this in the classroom to talk about, okay, what is in a freezer in the 1950s? What did they find as being valuable? So I think this is a fantastic ad. Now, in order to keep up with the expansion of the company, during the 1950s, Forstner really had to start hiring a large number of people. And as I mentioned before, this is a problem. If you have your factory in Middle Amana, you really got to think about where are you going to find your employees. His initial employees actually came out of the Amana colonies. They spoke German, and he hired women from the very beginning. Some of the oldest women that I were able to find in seniority records started working in 1945, and they were part of the Amana Society. Later on, when more and more people start working in Amana, they will be the Amana Society people will be very distinguishable from the rest of the workers. And in fact, the rest of the workers will refer to them as the Amana people because they could still speak German and they still had accents. So in order to find enough employees to fill his factory, he starts hiring women. And this is going to be very significant for Amana. The fact that he was open and willing to just employ women from the very beginning is different from a lot of different places. You know, the meatpacking plants or maybe some electronic companies will hire women, but they will put them into like segregated jobs saying, okay, this is women's work. That's definitely going on in meatpacking. In Amana, he will hire women to work on the assembly line, and men and women will work side by side. And I think this is very unique and very significant. And in fact, what's even more interesting is Maytag, which is, you know, right down the road in Newton, which made washers and dryers. They were very resistant to hiring women and did not hire women hardly at all. It was considered like a male breadwinner job, where you would hire men who were head of the households and they would go and work at Maytag. And the fact that Amana was just so open to hiring women from the very beginning is very significant. And I really think it's because of George Forstner's upbringing in the Amana Society. The fact that he had worked side by side with women and they had kind of a collective identity, they had this communal society where everyone's work was valued, I think that that is why Forstner didn't have this kind of hiccup to hiring women. The fact that he was willing to go out and immediately hire women. So this really sets Amana aside apart. So the company increases hiring in the 1950s. They maintain a steady rate of female employees until the end of the 50s. At the end of the 50s, the company has a little bit of trouble. The refrigerator, which had the freezer on the bottom and the refrigerator part on the top, had some issues with it. It wasn't working right, and the company really slows down. It nearly bankrupts them, and they have a series of layoffs during the 1957 and 1958. And in fact, there are no women hired during this period. So 1956 to 1965, there are no women hired. And there's very few people hired at all in the late 50s. And in the 1960s, they start hiring again, but women aren't going to be hired once again until the 1965. So according to the seniority lists that I've kind of looked through, there are about 1961, there are about 105 women working in the plant out of a total of 780. So women aren't a large group in the plant, but that's still around 13%. So this is pretty significant that the fact that he's even hiring women, but that they're over 10% of the total workforce. And then in July of 1966, there are about 110 women working out of a total of 1,112. Then in 1965, George Forstner actually sells the company to Raytheon Corporation. And Raytheon will implement several different changes, but they're really going to start expanding production, namely because they're going to start making the microwave. And the first microwave was pioneered by Amana, and they produced the radar range microwave oven. And they are going to be the first ones to really pioneer this and to sell it and to market it. First, they had to convince people that, you know, using tiny amounts of radiation to cook food was actually okay. Because at first people were like, I don't know if we should use this. This is pretty sketchy, pretty dangerous. And they really had to convince consumers that it was actually okay to use the microwave. And once the consumers realized that it was a very convenient thing to have in your home, it's going to boom. So the radar range is going to be their big market, their big consumer product. And they're going to really start hiring tremendously in the 1970s. So by 1966, when they start hiring women again, employment really picks up considerably. So there are about 263 women working in 1972 out of 1,107 employees. So it's about 24%. So the percentage of women is increasing. Then by 1974, there's 598 women working, which is about 38% of the total workforce. So by the 1970s, you have more women working as a whole. But between 1961 and 1974, women are going to compose right around 20% of the total workforce. So where did these women come from? They're coming from all over the area, driving 30, 40 miles one way to work. And I went through all of the grievances, about 20 years of grievances, and in some of the grievances, they actually put down what towns that they came from. So I was able to kind of really pinpoint in a circular way where the people are coming from. And there's about 180 towns listed. So out of the grievances, there's about 180 towns. Now, nearly every town in Iowa County, which is where Amana is, they had women working at the plant. The surrounding counties, in Benton County, there were 6 towns where women came from. Tama, there was 3 towns. Poweshiek, there was 5 towns. Keokuk, there's 9. And then in Washington County, there was just one worker that came all the way from Washington. And that's quite a bit of ways. So Washington's about 40 miles away from Amana. And then in Mahaska, there's from New Sharon. I do have a map here, let's see if this will work, if it's connected to the internet.
No, you're not.
You're not? Okay. that I was going to show you on a map, but really with Amana, it was smack dab in the middle of Iowa County. All of Iowa County, you have workers coming from all of the towns. Not so much from Cedar Rapids. There's about a few from Cedar Rapids, but you know, most workers are finding jobs in Cedar Rapids. It's really just like Iowa County and right next door, and I think that's right next door is Poweshiek, and then Tama, the southern part of Tama County, and then a little bit south. So right around this area where it's very rural, very few factories, that these are where women are coming from, because this is pretty much the only place that they could find a good job. As far as specific towns, Marengo, which is right on Highway 6 in Iowa County, had the most female workers with 32 residing in Marengo, which makes sense because it's the largest town in Iowa County. It's the largest town that's nearby the Amana colonies, and it's right on Highway 6. And Highway 6, most of the towns along there, because it's pretty easy for workers to just hop on the highway and get into Amana. So the towns along Highway 6 will spend a lot of workers. Belle Plaine had 17 women living there. Williamsburg had 13 women working there. And then the remainder of the 45 towns had less than 10 women commuting there. So there's 45 other towns in the area where women are coming from. So this pie chart, I think, kind of gives you an idea of of where the women are coming from, that you know, over half of them are just coming from these tiny towns. And most of these towns have less than 1,000 people living in them. So it's very rural, very small town. And this makes Amana a very unique workplace. You know, that people are coming from these tiny towns. It's a very rural workforce. They have to commute just to get to work, up to 30 miles, sometimes 40 miles. And this makes the workforce, you know, very distinctive. The fact that you can't form some type of collective identity as workers by just going out to your neighborhoods, which is how a lot of labor working class history, which have studied workers and the creation of a working class consciousness, they study the neighborhoods and how people are be able to kind of form identity by being right next door to the people you work with. And this makes, you know, the workforce completely scattered. So the process of having kind of a collective working identity is going to be having to form right there in the plant. And this makes Amana a very distinctive place. Workers are going to be able to form a working class identity and consciousness in the workplace, but they're going to have to do it there, or they're going to have to do it in the union hall, or they're going to have to do it while they're commuting back and forth. So I imagine that many of the conversations that are taking place in these vehicles as they're commuting back and forth, we'll talk about workplace grievances and what's going on in the workplace. Unfortunately, there's not like a microphone in these cars to like record what people are talking about, so it's kind of hard to figure out exactly what these conversations were. But that's kind of what makes Amana very distinctive and unique. So what are some things that women did while they were in the plant? Most of them, the majority of them, are going to work as assemblers. I went through about 20 years of grievances, and there were about 405 women who filed grievances in this 20-year period. And out of that, about 136 of them are going to report working as assemblers. So this is about 33% will work on the assembly line. And assembly work is kind of your most basic job category, your most basic work. It fell into grade 3 pay racket. Grade 1 was the lowest. They usually earned between $1.31 and $1.36 an hour in 1954. And I went through got online and did the converter. And so today in 2012, actually, that would be about $11.20 to $11.62 an hour. So not real high pay, but you're a good solid job that you can make some money. And the fact that so many women were willing to commute 20 miles to go to work, this really shows that this is going to be higher pay than what most women are going to be able to do in 1954. So some of the jobs they did along the assembly line was placing doors, placing liners, placing shelves, screwing on door handles, inserting liners in installation, moving parts from one conveyor belt to another, and applying sealers. So this is just your basic assembly line on your refrigeration products. About 5 out of the 136 women who worked in the assembly category, 5 of them will manage to move up into first class assembly, which requires more skill and a higher pay category. So there's some flexibility here that women are able to kind of bump up to first class assembly, but most of them stay right in second class assembly category. The next one is brazing, and this is something that requires more skill and more training, and it's one of the more unique jobs at the plant. Brazing is basically, it's a type of welding where you take metal parts and put them together by heating them with an acetylene torch or an electric welder, and they would melt or solder brass or silver to join them into a joint. So this takes a little bit more skill. This is your welding. And the fact that women were able to do this was pretty significant because most of the skilled trades were shut out to women. But at Amana, many of them were able to continue to do welding. And this is kind of a hangover from World War II, where when women went to work in the plants during the war, they learned how to weld. And one of the, you know, you have Rosie the Riveter and you have like Winnie the Welder. And so women were able to use those skills and transport them into factories and work as welders pretty early on. Later on, this is going to be harder for women to get these jobs, But in the early 1950s, when the plant was really starting up, a lot of women were able to work as welders. Now, brazing was in the grade 5 category. Women made between $1.46 and $1.56 an hour. And they also worked as spot welders, which was also in this category. The next one is a heliarc welder. This is a much more skilled welding job. It was in grade 7. And they earned between $1.56 and $1.66 an hour. And heliarc welding is very similar to brazing, but you're using a gas electric torch to do the welding. I assume it's using helium, which is why it's called a heliarc torch. I'm not too familiar with it. But the heliarc welder took more skill. This is why it was placed in a higher job category. Now, the rest of the jobs are kind of just miscellaneous jobs. They worked as inspectors, leak detectors, and as janitors. But women are really shut out from the highest paid categories. These are your skilled trades, your tool and die workers, your electricians, your plumbers, and technicians. And this is pretty typical of most factory jobs at this time, that women are able to work in the lower pay categories. But the highest paid job categories, where you had the most skilled work, women are allowed and had very difficult time getting into the higher paid categories. And that's just simply because welders and skilled tradesmen, or not welders, I'm sorry, your tool and die workers, your machinists, these are your more skilled jobs. And so men will pass on their skill and through like an apprenticeship system or journeyman system, and they kept the knowledge very close to them. And so they were resistant to having women learn their trade. And this is kind of how women were kept out of the highest paid categories. This won't change until the 1970s and affirmative action policies and the women's rights movement, where more women are going to push through these barriers. But the fact that like a woman would be a machinist in 1950 is pretty much unheard of. And women were actually pretty accepting of this. Most of the women did not want to actually go and be a machinist. They didn't think that was really part of their responsibility. So at Amana, most of the women are in the middling job categories. And what was really interesting is early on in the 50s, these job categories were pretty malleable and flexible. And then the fact that women could really work as heliarc welders was significant. As time goes on, these become more solidified, and it's going to be harder for women to bump up into the higher job categories until we get to the 1970s with affirmative action policies. But very early on in the plant, the fact that these categories were so malleable and flexible, they had this kind of brief moment where women could earn higher wages and kind of work in these higher job categories. So that's kind of what the women are doing in the plant. And then by analyzing the grievances that they submitted, we kind of get an idea of some of the themes that people were grieving about, what they were complaining about. But first, I want to talk a little bit about how the union came into the plant. And it's actually pretty interesting that it's one of the most unique union stories that I have ever encountered. Because of reading the oral history accounts, everyone was like, oh yeah, George Forstner didn't have a problem with the union. It was just kind of like, okay, yeah, let's have a union. And I was just like, no, this can't be. Like, there's supposed to be some sort of fight. There's supposed to like be some sort of resistance. But they all agree that, yeah, George Forstner was just okay having the union in the plant. And I really think this is because Forstner's heritage of being in the Amana society, that he grew up in this communal society where everyone worked together, and so I don't think he had a problem with the union initially. Later on, as he gets into more business practices and when the company is sold to Raytheon, then he gets more resistance, we'll start fighting with the union. But in 1952, when the plant is organized, he really didn't have a trouble with it. And the story that is told is that the Teamsters were hauling material to the plant, and the Teamsters were saying, we're going to stop hauling material to your plant until you unionize. And so this kind of threat of boycott that the Teamsters say, you need to unionize or we're going to stop hauling stuff to your plant, and then that made Forstner think, well, all right, you know, I don't want this boycott. And then the workers themselves chose to go with the machinist union, and they formed the machinist union local 1526 in 1952. And so that's when most of the grievances start. They had a very good grievance system policy where workers could file grievances and submit them. And they kept all of these records, which is fabulous for me. I actually can go and read through these grievances. They listed where they were from and what jobs they held and some of their main issues. So there's kind of different themes of what they chose to grieve about. The first one is better working conditions. And this is going to be the most populist of all the grievances. Most of them actually were filed about bumping, wanting to bump into different job categories. Other than that, which is kind of just your more boring grievance of like, okay, I want to move into this job and that type of thing. The second most one was better working conditions. So out of the sample of ones that don't talk about bumping, which are all the ones in this category here, there's 111 of them, 26 of them will file on working conditions. Women will complain about fumes, poor ventilation, they'll get headaches, extreme heat or cold, and if they had an issue in their workplace, a group of them will then collectively file grievances saying, hey, we're having too much fumes in this area, can you please fix this? One example of this is in May of 1955, when a group of women complained about excess smoke and odor in their work area caused by vacuum pumps. I have a quote here by Leona Roberts, who said, quote, we need a vent above the vacuum pumps to take away the smoke and odor. It gives me a headache, sore throat, and my eyes burn. So two other women filed and complained about the fumes as well. And I'm sure men are working in this area too, and the men would file grievances too, but I just looked at the grievances that were filed by women. And so usually, I'm not sure if the company fixed this immediately, but usually the company would, especially in the early 1950s. They would come in and fix the area so that they would not be inhaling all of these fumes. The second one is overtime, and there's a lot of frequent complaints about missed opportunities for overtime. So about 25 grievances were filed for overtime. And how the company did overtime is they would give it out by seniority. So the woman with the highest seniority would have the first chance at overtime. And if she missed the chance for overtime, she would file a grievance. And then the company would just kind of say, oh, yeah, my bad. We should have given this to you first. Here, I'll pay you for it otherwise, or we'll give you first chance at overtime. So initially, the company was very flexible about this, about giving people chances at overtime. And after a while, though, the company is going to stop this practice, especially when they switch over to Raytheon in 1967, and that's when you have much more business practices put into place. And then they'll keep filing these grievances, and the company completely changes to say, oh, well, you know, sorry, we'll try to get you overtime next time. So things were going to kind of change by 1967, but initially they had a lot of chances at overtime and they wanted to protect it. So if a woman missed a chance at overtime, she was right there filing a grievance and saying, hey, I want overtime, make sure you give this to me. And I just think that really shows that women wanted to work and they were there to work and they wanted to make as much money as they could. And very similar to that theme is that they want higher job classifications. Women are going to turn in a lot of grievances for higher job classifications. There's about 19 grievances submitted over job classifications. And this is initially done in the early days of the union and the company when they're still trying to figure out the different job grades and what the different categories should be. And this made the company very flexible, the job grades very flexible. And what they would do is if enough women would complain, we want this job to be the next pay grade, then the company would respond, okay, I see what you're saying, we'll talk about it in the next contract negotiation, and then they would kind of take this into account and change it. And in fact, this what happened is that there was a third class assembly category, and so many of the people that were working in third class assembly wanted to be in second class assembly that eventually they completely did away with third class assembly and everyone bumped into second class assembly. So initially the company, you know, is really listening to their workers and listening to these grievances, and they were able to kind of bump up. once again, later on, by the end of the 60s, these kind of practices are done away with, and women and the workers don't have the ability to really influence them as much. An example of this would be Emma Stiegel, who in January of 1954 wanted a higher classification than second class assembly because she thought her job required more skill. And she writes, quote, that her job requires accuracy and also skill. It is a job that required a great deal of training, and I've been doing this testing for almost a year, unquote. So she wanted first class assembly. I don't think that she's going to be successful in this. Sometimes they were picky, but this is the type of grievance that they would file. The next one is the speed of the line. Another common complaint was how fast the line was going. And this happened much more frequently later on, actually, when the company is pushing production, speeding up the line, and trying to get the workers to work more. And if a woman was not able to keep up, she would be reprimanded. And then eventually, if she continued to have poor production, then she would be removed and put into a different job category. So women would complain about the speed of the line, that it was too difficult, or complain about their job, that if they had to like move big, heavy refrigerator doors from one conveyor belt to the next, they would kind of complain that this job was too difficult. And often, if they couldn't do a particular job, they would then switch. Or if they were written up for whatever reason, they would then complain and say, why was I written up? You know, the line's going too fast. So that was another category. And also what comes out of this is some conflicts with the foremen. The foremen are usually male, and I don't know if there were really very many female foremen. And so they're kind of, you know, keeping the line on their female workers. If a woman felt like her rights were violated, if the foreman was being too ridiculous, she would write up a grievance. And one of my favorite stories that came out of this is in May of 1970, when Helen Brown got really upset with her foreman and wrote up this really long, lengthy grievance. And Helen Brown was a bit of a talker. She was known to be going out and talking to people. But she was going out to something, and she ran into the Coke guy who was refilling the Coke machine. And he manages to stop and ask her a question. So she was answering his question, and the foreman came up because he was wondering, where did Helen go? He came out and find her. He yelled at her in front of the Coke guy and reprimanded her and told her to get back to the line. And she was so upset by this that he just like totally embarrassed her in front of the foreman. And she wrote up a grievance against this, saying that the foreman this is reprehensible, and he should not be doing this. And she wrote, quote, this is not the first time he has nastily approached me in this manner. I know we have rules, regulations, and limitations, but they are made for all, not me alone. He never bothered to find out why I was talking to the Coke representative. And I think it is only common courtesy to answer a question when asked one. So she was just really furious about how he treated her. And really similar to some of the conflicts that will come into play with the foreman is access to restroom breaks. And I think this is a really interesting aspect of the Amana story and life in the factory, is that women are going to make sure that they have access to the restroom. And if they feel threatened that they cannot go to the bathroom when they need to, they will write up a series of grievances and make sure that they are going to be able to have access to the restroom. This happened in January of 1957, when the company was trying to crack down on women who were leaving the line to go use the bathroom. And they are just going to really respond as a group and be really upset with this, because they had a break in the morning and the afternoon, and what would happen is that women wouldn't go to use the bathroom during the break, because if all of the women in the plant are using the bathroom at the exact same time, you're going to have lots of lines, and you have to actually walk all the way to the bathroom. So it could be a 5-minute walk just to get to the bathroom. You're not going to have time to go to the restroom on your break. So what they wanted was to be able to just go to the bathroom throughout the day when they needed to go. And foremen are starting to complain about women leaving the line too much. And Dorothy Reinhart writes this grievance. She, quote, what do you call a good reason for being absent from the department? The only times you allow, as you say, for going to the restroom is 8:30 and 2, and only 5 minutes It is impossible for us to walk out there, go to the restroom, and be back in time allowed as for the other three times you speak of. That is our time. Did you ever try to figure out how long it would take everyone in the plant to go to the restroom? We're doing you a favor as for the interruption. We are a long ways from being behind on schedule talks here. I hope you don't think the foreman does all the work back here. He's too busy holding down the stool he sits on. It is not our fault that it takes so long to get out to the restroom and back, unquote. Vivian Shaw also complained with this. She says, I don't loiter. I can't see why it doesn't concern everyone instead of just the people on the liner department. It can't be possible for everyone to go at the same time. I feel this is very unfair, as we have always had this privilege before. The distance we have to walk is too far for anyone to go if it wasn't necessary, unquote. So I think this is that one of these rights, that just to be able to go to the bathroom when you need to. And another thing that's kind of underlying all of this is the gender dimension of women who work and having a male foreman, and they have menstrual cycles. So, you know, once a month, women will be on their menstrual cycle. The last thing they want to do is go and tell their foreman that, oh, I am on my menstrual cycle, I need to go to the restroom, because this is still the 1950s. You know, people are still, you know, very secretive about their menstrual cycles, so they don't want to have to bring this up. So part of this access to the restroom is just being able to take care of business while they're on their menstrual cycle. So there's this kind of this underlying gender dimension that is going on with these access to restrooms. And the other thing that I think is interesting about the restroom is they will always make sure that it looks really nice. They'll have a place to sit. They'll have like maybe flake flowers in there. They'll have a cigar tray. And it's a place for women to go and escape the life of the factory. It's a place for them to go and relax and get away from their male foreman. I know men will use the restroom too, but I think that for women, it definitely has this gender dimension to it, that they can go to the bathroom, get away from their male foreman, and kind of group talk with other women in the plant and kind of bond with other women. So I think that the restroom dimension is one of the more interesting things that have come out of the grievances. So overall, what can we learn from all of these different grievances? So what I've kind of learned from and what I've kind of gathered is that women take their jobs very seriously. They want to make sure that they're being paid. They want to have access to overtime because they're there to help support their families. They're taking a risk by going to work outside of the home in the 1950s. So they're there to work and they're there to make money. And so they want to make sure that they're getting paid as much as they possibly can by being in the highest grade category that they can get, and that they are getting as much overtime as they possibly can. They also value good working conditions. You know, if they want to go and be safe in the factory, they don't want to get sick and have headaches every day from inhaling fumes. So they will work together to make sure that their workplace is a good environment, that it's not too cold or too hot, or especially that they're not inhaling too many fumes or too much exhaust, and that they have good ventilation. And also they want to make sure that their individual rights were protected. They are willing to stand up for themselves. If a foreman is too mean to them, they're not afraid to write a grievance. It's like, you know, I'm a person, I deserve to be treated as a person. And that they have access to the restroom, which is just a basic human need, that you need to go to the bathroom. And that they would be able to go to the bathroom and be relieved on the line and use the restroom. Let me see if I have. Nope, that's the end of my slide. So kind of in conclusion, why Amana? Why study Amana? I think that we can really learn a lot about the female workforce in Iowa, that it's very rural, that they're driving really long distances, and that in places like Amana, women do have chances to work in kind of more skilled jobs. They're not just working in kind of segregated units. And they're working side by side by men, which is very different from maybe some of the other jobs, such as in meatpacking, where they're only working with women. And I think this Amana definitely provides a more rural perspective on industry and manufacturing. So much of what is studied is on factories that are done in cities, in urban areas. But in the 1950s, all across Iowa, you have plants like Amana, where you're hiring more rural workers, and the manufacturing is done in greater extent in these more small towns and rural areas. And that's kind of the general argument of my whole entire dissertation is, you know, studying manufacturing done in more rural areas, studying how that affected women in these areas. And I think Amana really kind of demonstrates that. So that's kind of the end of my presentation, and I'd like to open up for questions.
I'm just curious about whether you could see in the grievances, were those German women filing grievances to the extent that the other women were, and if there was a difference?
Yeah, that's a really great question. I think that later on, that definitely in the 50s, there's more outside women that are being hired. So there's only like a tiny handful of the German women. But I know like the two earliest women were Ethel Wessling and Janice Wessling. I think that they were sisters, I'm not quite sure. And they do file grievances just as much. So it's hard to distinguish whether there was a difference. So.
I have two questions based on what the research materials would yield. Is one, whether you could distinguish, or whether the materials distinguish between farm women and women who lived in small towns. And the second, were women working night shifts as well when they might have, as day shifts, when they might have had more home or family responsibilities?
I'll take the second one first. Yeah, women are working on the second shift. Can't remember now if they started with the overnight shift when the plant first started, but women are definitely working second shift. And sometimes their husbands will work at the plant too, so they'll swap shifts. So the husband will work the first shift and the wife will work the second shift so that somebody can watch the kids. Or they do it the other way, they want to both work the same shift so they can commute together. And so then they'll have somebody watch the children. And I'm not quite sure who they would find. Most likely I would think family members are the ones who are watching the children, but they definitely were working night shifts. And the first question is, if there are farm women, sometimes it's hard to distinguish. I know that when they're filing the grievances, they will write rural route addresses down. So I know that there are some women who are living in farms, but I'm not able to determine the percentage of how many of these were actually farm women and how many of them were just living in small towns. So, but it's definitely very rural. I mean, the towns are like less than 1,000 people. So most of them have some sort of farm background.
Well, it's great to hear your talk and what you've done with all of those interviews. I was wondering about, you talked about George Forshner, and did anybody ever interview him and get information? That would be one question. And then the other was, you alluded to his sort of the fact that he grew up in the Amanas and that influenced his decisions and perhaps his sort of acceptance of the union. To what extent did the Amana church influence that? Because I think that would have been a big factor, and I wondered if you looked at that.
Okay. I know that people have... I don't know if there's an actual oral interview with him. I know people have made this collection of remembrances of George Forstner. I'm sure that somewhere like a business magazine has interviewed him, but I don't know if actual oral history has ever been done with him. So that would be something I would need to investigate more. I'm not sure of. And as far as the Amana Church influencing, that's a really great question because you know the Amana Society was the main investors initially. So that would be something that I would try to see if I could connect if the Amana Society is definitely kind of influencing in employment hiring practices. So that's a great thing to investigate further.
I'll just add a footnote that Harold Pitts and Wayne Gettings of Amana Refrigeration Association have gathered together many three-ring notebooks full of information. They had hoped to create a museum out in the Amana colonies to Amana Refrigeration. And Corey got to look at some of that material, but it's still something that's sort of out there and hasn't really been in an archive yet for her to look at. And
I remember looking at it. I just couldn't remember the name of it off the top of my head.
I think maybe Peter might be able to address the church question.
No? Okay. Anybody else?
Not the church question. the period you're looking at, it sounds like there's an interesting sort of change in the culture of the plant over this time. Part of it is the introduction of the union in 1952. But I'm wondering, in terms of the grievances, and maybe you addressed this, but I didn't catch it, is there a significant change over time, both in the number of grievances being filed and the kinds of grievances being filed, that would reflect the sort of underlying changes that are going on in work and supervision and ultimately the change in ownership?
Definitely, there's a significant change in the themes. Early on, women are complaining about wanting higher job classifications. That really just drops off by 1967 because the company, once Raytheon comes in, they're saying, we're in charge, this is how it is. They're gonna take a much more hardline approach to the union and to the workers. And so after 1967, since I didn't study those as closely, I'm not able to really remember what exactly they're going to really fight for. But I know that there is divisions within the union itself, and that one particular individual will take over the union and try to like be much more hardline with the company, and a lot of the workers are going to be resistant to that because they're more easygoing and they want to work with the company. So there you have the split within the union after 1967 itself. So that's like another really long story.
But the speed of the line, for instance, one might think that, I'm not sure this thing is working. Is it? That over time, that this becomes more of an issue as the company becomes more interested in rising productivity and getting more out of the workers.
Yeah, and you'll see more people, women, being displaced because they can't keep up, or they can't keep up with a certain job, or they're definitely much more concerned with production quotas, and that women are making sure they're keeping up with production quotas. So there's definitely changes in that aspect too. So that I would really need to go for and like really study the grievances as they change over time. And so I want to go on and do this more closely, but it's something I plan to do.
You mentioned early on a comparison with Maytag, and I was wondering if, and that there were a higher proportion of men there. I was wondering if you happen to know, have a salary or wage comparison between the two.
Yeah, that would be really great, but I don't. but that would be something to definitely compare about. And I'm not sure if Maytag actually started hiring women later on, after the 50s. It was something I meant to, I know there's been a lot of research done on Maytag, and somebody's written a book that talks a lot about the Maytag plant in Newton. And I remember asking her one time, I emailed her about this difference, and she never got back to me. So it's something that I really want to pursue further to figure out.
Were women working at Amana during the Second World War? So is there an earlier period of women working in that factory?
I believe so, but since what I'm looking at is the grievance records, so I wasn't able to really figure out exactly when women started working. But I know the earliest women are working in 1945, so that's the earliest account that I've found. But I do believe that the women are working right from the very beginning.
Thanks. I really enjoyed hearing what you've gleaned from the grievance records so far. And I guess another question I had was, did that give you glimpses into the role of women within the union itself? I mean, some of the excerpts you read to us suggest that at the very least women are writing their own grievances. Are they also handling their grievances, taking on certain leadership roles and representing themselves or others? Or were you able to tell that?
Yeah, women are getting involved in the union. Initially, most of the union leadership is going to be all male, the main leadership positions, but women do become stewards. They do become like recording secretaries, and they are later on in the late 60s and 70s, you'll have more women taking on leadership positions. So women are definitely very involved, and their voices are heard in the union. So it is, I want to say, more democratic than some of the other, like maybe meatpacking unions were at the same period. So women are definitely involved and have their voices heard. But you're not going to have a female president until about the end of the 1970s, when you'll actually get a female president of the union. It'll all stay, like vice president and president will stay within the hands of male leadership.
Oh, okay, that's interesting, and that answers one of my questions, because the local right now actually has a woman president, and I wasn't sure whether this was the first time or not. But
it's not the first time.
Okay. She might want to say something about that. And then, I mean, to go back to, I think, the point Shell was raising about changes over time, I was also curious whether you saw changes in the kinds of involvement women had over that 20-year period. And then also just wanted to ask, are there negotiation records? Since, you know, the filing of grievances, of course, is sort of the day-to-day negotiation of that contract, but it's happening always in relation to bargaining the contract. And some of the changes, I assume, in the trends you're seeing in the grievance record are going to relate to changes in the contractual language, and if there's evidence of how that's changing.
Yeah. There is more like a negotiation of the contract. I think that where you can really see this is in the beginning, where they get rid of that third class assembly position. So the union is really working with the company, and you have a much more like good relationship. Whereas later on, the company is more resistant to change, more resistant to workers telling them things, and even in the union itself becomes much more a hardline approach. So you don't have as good of a relationship later on. If that kind of answers your question to a little bit, but you definitely do see a split between what is going on in the 1950s and what's going on later on in the 1960s. So,
kind of to add to that, I do currently work at the plant, and I am in union leadership. A lot of the grievances change through the times because of the collective bargaining, the laws, OSHA, all of those, all the way up to legislative, it all has a bearing on the work conditions, our contract, and what grievances follow that.
So really there's a relationship between the contract, the laws, and what's going on in the workplace itself. It's all kind of all bundled up together. Yeah.
Hi, thank you for the talk. I really enjoyed it. You mentioned that you worked mainly in the women's grievances, but what I'm wondering is, did you get a chance to look at the grievances as a whole to see if the female grievances were indicative overall? I mean, so are the men, you know, overall as a union, have those same kind of distribution and categories?
Yeah, I believe so, that they are indicative of grievances overall. That especially when it, in a particular workplace, if they are having issues with ventilation, then everyone in that particular workplace will file the grievance. So the men are filing it along with the women. As far as the restroom goes, I think that was one thing that women are really going to be particular about, to make sure that they have good access to the restroom breaks. I don't think it was as big of an issue with the men. But that's about the only thing that really is different. Access to overtime, higher job categories, all of these are very similar to what the men are grieving as well. So, but I didn't get a chance to look too closely at the male grievances because there are a lot of them. So, I mean, I just remember spending hours and hours of going through all of these grievances. And I'm like, I hope this will pay off for me someday that I am doing all of this painstaking research on these grievances. So.
Do you have a sense of the marital status of most of the women workers? Were most of them married, and did that change over time?
I believe that most of them were married, and that most of them will go to work with their husbands. So you'll have a man and a wife who will go to work together at Amana. I think over time, maybe in the 1970s, you'll have more young single women who are going to work at Amana, and I think that might be the big change is in the 70s, when they start hiring more people, they start hiring more women, that you'll get more single women working in the plant.
Well, it just goes to show that there's great potential here for more research about Amana and the workers that work there, but we're really grateful that Corey came today. I want to remind everyone, this is just one chapter of a much larger dissertation, and she's donating that to us here today if you want to read more of this context that surrounds this story. Because sometimes when you're doing a broad sweep of the state like that, you can only dabble into some of these topic areas until you get the whole picture pulled together. So let's thank Corey again and appreciate it.
Watching City Channel 4 on TV, online, on demand, on Facebook, and now on the go on your mobile device.